My name is Sally Simpson. I am the director of the Center for the Study of Business Ethics, Regulation, and Crime, and a professor in the Department of Criminology and Criminal Justice. C-BERC, that's the shorthand for the Center for the Study of Business Ethics, Regulation, and Crime, is hosting the event today, along with the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences and the R.H. Smith School of Business, along with our sponsors, the Fishlinger family. And I'd like to take a moment to introduce Matt and Bill Fishlinger, who are here today. Please stand up for just a second, please. Bill and Matt are proud Terrapin alums, both earning baccalaureate degrees in government and politics, and I think Matt threw in a little philosophy too. Thank you so much for your support of the center. We're very grateful. It is now my privilege to introduce our speaker today, Jeffrey Sonnenfeld, who received an AB, MBA, and doctorate from Harvard University. He is no doubt familiar to many of you from his numerous appearances as expert commentator on CNBC and on PBS's Nightly Business Report. Or perhaps you read his columns for Fortune Magazine, Chief Executive Magazine, The Wall Street Journal, or The New York Times. If not, you will after his lecture today. Jeff is currently Senior Associate Dean for Executive Programs at Yale University School of Management and the Lester Crown Professor of Management Practice. He is also the founder president of the Yale Chief Executive Leadership Institute, the world's first CEO college. Previously, Sonnenfeld spent 10 years as a professor at the Harvard Business School, where as a postdoctoral scholar, I had the opportunity to learn his famous United Parcel Service case. Recently, Jeff was named by Business Week as one of the world's 10 most influential business school professors, and by directorship as one of the 100 most influential figures in governance. He's published over 200 scholarly articles and 7 books, including the bestsellers such as The Hero's Farewell, Leadership and Governance from the Inside Out, and Firing Back, How Great Business Leaders Rebound from Adversity. Today's talk, a play on his famous book, is titled The Hero's Farewell, Courage, Character, and Business Ethics in the Trump Era. He's written at some length about this topic, and I know you will find his lecture today very interesting. With no further ado, I give you Jeff Sonnenfeld.
Thank you very much. When you have all been in situations like this, certainly the renowned scholars in the room and old friends, students that have gathered here today and other colleagues, that when you're in front of a group like this, you know you always open up by telling people how honored you are. But in this case, I really mean it. I am truly honored you're here. It's not the most convenient time. For some of you, it's not the most convenient location for this mid-row from the business school that's come trudging over here, and others who did. I want to say that I'm honored that you've come out for this timing. This location, there were 4 or 5 of you that were here when I walked in the room to help set up the equipment. I notice you're still here, so I guess I haven't alienated you yet, but I suspected you came into this gorgeous new building, finished just in time for this talk, just about, for a nice, really pretty, quiet, dry place to study with great lighting. If I get too loud and annoy you, let me know, and I'll try to turn it down, but please stay. So I'm honored for that second reason. Third, Bill and Matt, of course, I should have started by saying how honored I am with you guys down here for the Distance Award, but I'm also a little unnerved because you traveled so far. I hoped you'd come down for some other reason. I was trying to invent some for you, and you're politely saying, you know, you didn't just wander in here because you noticed the name looked familiar, yours, not mine. But in fact, you've come down for this talk. So if nothing else, I have to make it worth your while. So I'll try not to offend 100% of your friends as I go or to soil the great family name too much, but I'll give it a try. I actually did have an ulterior reason for being down here, but we matched it with Sally's wonderful invitation, and that was I just came from a board meeting of the National Council on Aging. I'd written an article in the Harvard Business Review that only Hank Sims would remember that in 1978, dealing with an aging, yes, I'm that old, dealing with an aging workforce, back when I was 25, I know I need the goatee to look as distinguished as you. They invited me to join the board back then. So I was on the board of that group when I was 25, 26 years old, when we were once young faculty. I stayed on for a long time. I left the board, but I just recently rejoined it. This is my first meeting after being away for a decade. And a great thing that used to happen before each one of those board meetings, there'd always be a guard or a receptionist to say, "What can I do there for you, young fellow?" They didn't ask that this morning. So anyhow, that's another reason why I'm down here. Another reason why I'm honored is the gathering of who's here. As colleagues, I just want to say that Mike Bell, where's Mike? Right in front of me. Yeah, great. Mike, it's great to see you again. Mike was on a search committee where we won't get into all the gory fun details, although Hank knows it too from afar, where we were looking at coming to terms with me possibly coming in to torment you as a dean here at one point. But fortunately for the University of Maryland, the place came to its senses, and somehow we didn't conclude the deal a while back. We got awfully close, didn't we, Mike? And speaking of the deanship world, Judy Frells, where's Judy? Right here, as a scholar and educator in the world of business ethics. So I'm a little worried. And Hank, of course, Hank Sims has great expertise in this field and others, in organization, leadership, and strategy, in big trouble. Deborah Shapiro, also here, of course, as a management scholar superstar, although she has the courage to get even closer. She's served as our esteemed president of our, 12,000 person? 20,000. Oh my God, 20,000, yes. What is it? Yes, it's 20,000 scholars around the world that get together and talk at each other with the Academy of Management. So congratulations on this tour of duty that you've had there, as well as your heroic service here. So you can see there are an awful lot of great people in the room. So I'm so honored. If I forget what I'm saying, we could turn almost randomly in this room, and there's going to be somebody with equally or better insight to share on the topics we have today. And that's despite that introduction, which I should say in closing as a fifth point why I'm honored. It occurred to me that all those things that Sally said, as I looked over, some of your eyes started to glaze over by the fourth paragraph. And by the end of it, I even started to somewhat strongly dislike myself. So if you've hated me for that introduction, I did I send you all that material? I really apologize, but...
No, I did that all myself.
You did. Well, as we go back 20 years ago this day, I got... No, we've known each other 30, but it was 20 years ago, I got introduced as Joe and Donna DeLillo. I have two ringers in here who were with me back in Atlanta. I did a talk for Ted Turner's last retreat as they merged into the world of Time Warner. And they introduced a whole series of people before I started the talk. I thought it was me. He kind of slurred words, not as enunciating as clearly as you did, Sally. And so I started up, and he pushed me down to go sit down. He pointed out Larry King there in the audience, who was on the Turner World at CNN. Larry King talked about how many kings and queens and popes he'd interviewed just that very morning, and then all credibility I had for any name dropping was gone. So then I started up again, and then he spotted his then wife, Jane Fonda, in the group, brought her up, and she insulted everybody in the room. What was wrong with their air? It was about this many people, and their titles were all executive vice president, vice chairman, on up, and they all claimed to be direct reports to Ted. Average age, I think, was 26. And Jane just said that there's something wrong with Turner Classic Movies or Cartoon Network or Headline News. People still can't figure out quite that's what that's supposed to be, or CNN and things. Yeah, so they're all angry with veins bulging at the neck. So I started up again. Then he pushed me down yet another time because he spotted somebody who was at that point technically an employee of his who had created a Castle Rock film division, TV division, was sitting out there, and that was Billy Crystal. So then he brought Billy Crystal. So that one rehearsed opening joke you had disappeared as Billy Crystal had them in stitches. So I wasn't going to go up anymore. And then he motioned me. I wasn't falling for that. Anyhow, so I walked up there. And then I realized there's a guy on Thursday nights at that time that only five or six of you would realize was on must-see TV at that time, a Castle Rock distributed show on NBC, but it was a Turner-produced show with a similar-sounding name. Yes. Jerry Seinfeld. So after Billy Crystal and Larry King, Jane Fonda, and the way he slurs and not like Sally, they're all expecting, yes, Jerry Seinfeld to walk up. So if that's what you're expecting, I'm really sorry, but you know, if you're disappointed, you should have seen their faces. It was even worse. And I don't think he's got to go around the country apologizing for not being me. So much for the disclaimers. But okay, there's one more disclaimer. As we're in this gorgeous new facility, I've not been in this building, of course, before. And I don't know, do any of you know who Michael Bay is? Who? You shouldn't know, you're all too classy. He has the worst explosive pyrotechnics out there. And even more, as a few of you will remember, that Alfred Hitchcock used to argue that actors and actresses don't matter. It's all in the script, it's all in the writing. Michael Bay's taken it further, you know, with Transformers or Nightmare on Elm Street, whatever, all these explosive things, is Armageddon. He argues it's all the pyrotechnics, it's the digital special effects that drive. It doesn't even matter what you write, let alone what you say. And this was him just last year at the Consumer Electronics Show as the opening talk. Technology drives it all.
How is everyone today? My job as a director is I get to dream for a living.
Michael, you know, you're known for such unbelievable action. What inspires you? How do you come up with these unbelievable ideas?
I create visual worlds that are so beyond everyone's normal life experiences. And Hollywood is a place that creates a viewer escape. And what I try to do, as a director, I try to... the type is all off, sorry, but I'll just wing this.
Tell us what you think.
Yeah, we'll wing it right now. I try to take people on an emotional ride. And
the curve? How do you think it's going to impact how viewers experience your movies?
Excuse me, I'm sorry.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, let's thank Michael Bay for joining us.
That's a nice way to make $160,000, which they had to pay him because he committed to showing up and they failed to perform their side of the contract because they didn't have a working technology. So the teleprompter failed them, and the guy who says it's all driven by technology, when technology failed, he couldn't make heads or tails of it. That's my way of coming up with the disclaimer that in this room, so far I've seemed to have pushed the right buttons, but if in a minute, Gabriel, where are you hiding? Back there. If you start to see smoke arising from this podium and my hero back there, my savior, Gabriel, can't get up here in time, we'll just have to talk from what we know. But this topic, the hero's farewell, courage, character, and business ethics in the Trump era, where did this title come from? As Sally nicely says, it was derivative from an old book of mine. It was, but the title is hers, right? Didn't you come up with this title? So to satisfy the customer, you're getting a talk that's never been given before, not just a title that none of us have ever seen before. But I have an idea what we're going to do with it better than Michael Bay, I think. And that is, we're going to try to answer all these things because it's a big kettle of issues to wrap around. And I think there's a way of taking a look at character and courage, maybe even charisma, across sectors, eventually lighting on business, that might tie these issues together, because I really applaud, you know, Sally, your work as a great sociologist, as a great criminologist, and all the scholars in the world of business and elsewhere here. But wait a minute, we say here, well, this is really more here where we are, we're in the neighborhood of this. How ironic it is to be looking at courage and governance and leadership issues at this time when we're just hours away from the next budget stalemate, maybe we go off the cliff with our leaders unable to come together and come to terms. Can we turn to the public sector for the models we often learn from? In fact, Will Rogers said about our neighborhood, Congress is so strange, a person fights for the floor, gets up to speak, says absolutely nothing, nobody listens, and then everybody disagrees. You notice that Sally's the only one of the faculty who laughed, because it sounds like a faculty meeting most places, but anyway, it is across sectors. But the bottom line is, if I lose you in a blizzard of slides that I'm going through, we have 3.5 hours, right? Yeah. Is I've got the material for 3.5 hours. If you're wondering where it's all going at some point because you get lost in some stray slides, it comes back to this man and the model he set for us. Ken Frazier was the CEO of Merck. very high-performing company under his watch. It's extraordinary. They have a pipeline of 60 great new drugs, the most recent one coming out over the summer, Keytruda, which is really good for 7 really different virulent strains of cancer, extremely effective in lung cancer, some very promising returns on breast cancer. I have a close first cousin fighting for his life right now, getting this with leukemia. It's amazing, and he's just gone into a remission this morning, not to be melodramatic, but there are a lot of things to be proud of with Merck and under his leadership. But he also started out life as the son of a custodian, a janitor for UPS, and grandson of a janitor. Both his father and his grandfather read 3 to 5 newspapers a day. If anybody wants to follow him, it's just fine, but I'm sure he's just going to the men's room. But and then, or ladies' room, or both right here, is that Ken turned out to be quite a heroic leader in August, where he stood up and said something was wrong. It was in the aftermath of the Charlottesville response. You remember it was a Saturday night, I think, August 13th, where a woman was murdered. And then Sunday, the nation was paralyzed in shock. And Sunday, late Sunday, the president came out with this equivocation speech about all sides having shown good things and bad qualities, and that there was misconduct on all sides and things. And people were stunned and outraged that we weren't condemning Nazis and such violence. So Ken said, I can't be a part of the business roundtables before. He'd been pretty active. You would imagine every photo op they could, he was photographed with the president. He said, I have to step down. I need to take a stand because of my value system. The business roundtable, to this day, and I think all 22 members are their board of advisors. I like them very much. This is an organization that was founded in the early 1970s as a breakaway for largely progressive business leaders. Tom Watson, then of IBM, and Reginald Jones of GE, and Irving Shapiro of DuPont, and Clifton Garvin of Exxon, and across the board, these were people who looked at something that some of you may remember, the Tennessee Valley of Drums, but really bad chemical dumping, or Hooker Chemical of Occidental Petroleum and Love Canal and other things, or was it Lake Erie that caught on, Lake Superior caught on fire with that, said we need to speak out. And there was a great environmentalist concern around the country. There was the war, Vietnam War was tearing the country apart, it seems, and there were affirmative action issues. And the business community said, we need to find the win-win alignment here. And that's where they were. Sadly, very good people there right now. They've gone through a period of dormancy in intervening years, and right now they're selectively involved, but nobody backed up Ken, and I'll fill you in on that. And I thought he stood out in front. And the bottom line, the closing line, is I'm going to give you a quote. Again, if anybody has to dash out to the men's room or ladies' room and wants the closing quote now, it's going to be a line from Enemy of the People by Henrik Ibsen. There's a guy who said the town's water supply is polluted, a physician, Stockman was his name, in a Norwegian village. The town didn't want to hear it. They didn't want to hear the bad news. He wasn't sure, but people were coming by from all over Europe to swim in the supposedly medicinal spas, the fountains in this town, and they're getting sick. So he sent some vials of fluid away, and they tested and found, in fact, there was tannic acid in there from tanneries upstream. And nobody wanted to hear that, so he stood up at a town meeting and made it a public fact. He was condemned and run out of town. As Sally mentioned in the bio, in a reckless indiscretion of youth, I spent 18 years up at the evil Harvard. I used to try to teach this there. And maybe it'd be different now, but it was hard because he challenged the system, which was a big no-no to my MBAs then, and he failed. And Ibsen's, as a great champion of European democratization, had become frustrated about mobocracy by the end and disenchanted. And his admonition, the closing line of the play, to ruin it for you all, is the strongest person, he actually said the strongest man, but he would say the strongest person in the world is a person who can stand alone. And that's where I saw Ken Frazier. And his model was so strong, it set off a tidal wave, which was quite impressive. He went out on TV in the morning And I called around to business leaders.
In the drive into the studio here, I got 11 emails from Fortune 500 CEOs of outrage. I'm saying, say it publicly, but rather than pick them off one at a time, this is the whole reason we have the business roundtable, for collective action. I'd like to hear from Jamie Dimon, who is a good friend, but so was the...
He wasn't happy with me that day, though.
I'm a friend of mine, and Ken Frazier's a friend, to be perfectly candid with you.
Obviously a bad hair day, but I went into the studio really fast. Because I thought somebody should speak up, and they couldn't get any CEOs to go on air. And I figured, what have I got to lose other than a really bad image there?
Where's the voice of the collective voice of the business community? You know, last month on the 4th of July, there's a family of four struggling in the water off of Panama City, Florida. And then four people went out to try to save them. They had nine people all drowning in a horrible riptide. Nobody knew what to do. The police were on the beach. 80 people on the beach bonded together with their arms across races, religions, ages, and saved them. That's collective action. I think those beach people could teach, as beachgoers, those bathers, could teach a lot of the CEOs right now about leadership. This is what, where's the U.S. Chamber of Commerce? Where's the Business Roundtable? This is 40 years ago, the founding generation of the Business Roundtable would not have stood for this. They would have joined Ken in a second. I mean, what, is Howard Schultz right now sipping on his cappuccino and thinking of more clever things to write on coffee cups? What?
He wasn't very happy with me either.
Why not get out there and say something?
We have heard from Dimon, Jeff, and we had him on our air last week or the week before, and his point has consistently been... Exactly, but you expect him to somehow turn his back on the unveiling of serious tax reform because of this? That seems like a leap.
No, they're not. You know, out of self-interest, since you raised the self-interest angle, out of self-interest, tax reform, regulatory reform, trade matters, if they don't have the support of the general public, they're not going to get this through. So out of serious, their own self-interest, you would think that they would rally. And I think some of them will start to see more people even speak out on such matters, because they are the most trusted. If you look at the Edelman Trust Barometer, they and frankly academics, unlike clergy and public officials, have soaring trust factors right now in terms of being major influencers in society. CEOs are highly respected. No matter what you think about this company or that company, collectively they're a force of moral integrity. You know, as Benjamin Franklin had once warned, I'm a native Philadelphian, if we don't hang together, then we all hang separately. You can start picking off CEO after CEO the way Ken was attacked wrongly by the president on the exact wrong issues to attack him on. But you can take a look at any CEO, any one of us. We're all vulnerable somehow. If they work together collectively, that's how they fix this thing.
And that is what eventually happened. Is Paul Pullman of Unilever and Meg Whitman of still at HP spoke out very quickly in his defense. Bob Iger was furious because he actually spoke out ahead of, but had left the White House advisory councils earlier. But Bob Iger of Disney then re-entered the discussion to make sure he was heard. And then that was it, silence. So I talked with many people privately, and I will share their names privately, of big largest retailers in the country and largest nearby food manufacturers this area and things. And they just said, you know, we just got to get our boards behind us. This is extremely helpful. Can you write something, which I did? And what else can be done? Little by little, there was a second wave where happily for the University of Maryland, Kevin Plank jumped on board. I took a courageous stand. There were some technology companies, Intel spoke out at that point, UPS spoke out. They said, we're not exactly sure if we're going to leave the business round, these trade associations, the President's Advisory Council. We're thinking about it. We do know that Ken Frazier is a very good man. His character should never be attacked. In fact, his dad had been a janitor at UPS for 30 years, and he's part of our family, and Merck is a great company, and we're thinking about whether or not we withdraw. And others jumped on board. Then Ginni Rometty and Ingenui and Mary Barra of IBM, Pepsi, and GM had a conference call together and worked collectively. Neither one of those three, one for various obvious reasons, wanted to step out by themselves on this matter. Collectively, they did. Very quickly, BlackRock, Larry Fink. And then there's this third wave. So this horrible murder happened on a Saturday night. There's a response, silence, punctuated again with a third wave. Then, between 3:30 and 4 o'clock on the Wednesday, it was comical, the distress. at all the cable channels as they're being flooded by public relations flags, all racing in that we're quitting messages because the cracks on the dam were spreading so quickly. These groups are all going to dissolve, and people who weren't sure all wanted to be on the right side of history. And we could see that suddenly things had changed. So what happened there? There's where there's a model to follow and something to understand about business leaders. And the lessons were what Ken Frazier modeled for us, and he's not the only great business leader. There are tons of them. In fact, greatness and moral character can be in many, if not all, of us. You need somebody to model it. Now, we certainly have had this in the business world and other realms. Tomorrow in class, I'll have Sharon Watkins, who is one of these great three great whistleblowers. Now, she was a checkered whistleblower. She sold her holdings, and she ran all around on the inside, and people complained that on the Enron collapse, she didn't notify all the authorities, but she eventually later did. But it's a very interesting story of what she went through. In the early days, she had come in from the outside from Anderson, and moved in to take on the challenges at Enron, and wasn't so sure how much she wanted to speak out at that point.
The day after Stern resigned, Sharon Watkins sent a letter to Ken Lay.
We will begin with Ms. Watkins.
I'm Sharon Watkins.
Would you identify your counsel for the committee?
Yes, my counsel is Mr. Philip Hilder.
When you hear the story for the first time, it's unbelievable. What Sharon was telling me was more than accounting irregularities as such. I mean, it was a massive fraud of enormous proportions.
In mid to late June of 2001, upon the resignation of Cliff Baxter, I went to work directly for Mr. Fastow.
It has evolved to the corporate crime of the century.
I was
She's sitting one person away from the person she's accusing. That's Jeff Skilling with Jeff Skilling's lawyer. In between the two of them. How intimidating that is to be down the street here in Congress going through this as a whistleblower without the deep-pocketed resources that at least Ken Frazier had. Ken Frazier had the support of his board. He's been well paid. He has a track record. What did Sharon Watkins have to draw on? What would this mean for her?
Enron has almost two dozen felons, people that either pled guilty or were found guilty in court. I felt like I was the loyal employee, but I have this whistleblower lady.
My name is Sharon Watkins. I used to be a vice president at the Enron Corporation. I had been at Enron for 8 years and really stumbled across this income statement fraud. I just had a spreadsheet where the math didn't add up. And I kept asking question after question. I thought I was putting enough evidence in front of the chairman of Enron's board. But his first action was to see if he could silence the messenger. People say, oh, you're not really a whistleblower, you didn't go outside the company. And I said, that's right. My goal was to have the company live, not go bankrupt. I've been speaking the last decade.
That's pretty much what she does. At our CEO summits, when we have her there, everybody listens with rapt attention. However, during the breaks, people run for cover. The CEOs don't want to be caught in the photo op next to her. Whereas the fellow academics were all over her like a cheap suit to get her to come to our classes, as I do. You wonder, what are the consequences for people? And are CEOs heroic, as we sometimes talk about them, as I will tell you that I think Ken Frazier and many others are? Or like Sharon Watkins, who had to look elsewhere in the organization to find the heroism? You mentioned Sharon Watkins, we think of Enron, you think of this whole list. I don't know if you can see this list, but if you were to go back a dozen, 15 years, and think of the governance meltdowns we had at that time, what's the worst one on this list? Which one would you say is the one that troubles you the most, comes to mind? Anybody? There's no safe seat in the room. Hank, which one would you come up with? Oops. I'm not supposed to see that.
It's the worst, but I noted Hewlett Packard there. It catches my attention.
They had some
probably not the worst
difficult scandals with Hewlett Packard because of the pretexting and waves of CEOs being terminated for misconduct issues that tie back in. We even had a CEO caught up with a porn star, as we are back in the headlines again, sadly today, in different sectors. But other, yeah.
I probably lump in Citibank and the mortgage fraud that was going on that brought down the financial crisis.
Yeah, that's where a lot of the reckless predatory lending was. It sort of harkens back to perhaps where some Wells Fargo punishment is today on different reasons, but gets back into that same sector. Wells Fargo, by the way, I think is being unduly punished today. I think they've actually cleaned up their act. They've changed over more than half of the board. They've changed over, you know, like 80% of the leadership, and yet they're still being punished for stuff that was awful, but that they are trying to correct. And sometimes it's really hard to get a clean break when your predecessors have made a mistake. I wrote some materials on behalf of the turnaround board and leadership of Penn State. And for about a month, my wife had me start her car for her. People were so angry at me, these Joe Paterno football fanatics. I hadn't said anything good or bad about Paterno. I just said sometimes after you have a really bad incident, how does an institution learn? How can it go on? And we have some Penn State alums in the room here. But what could they have learned from that to try to be accountable? And they brought in FBI, former FBI chief Louis Freeh. They had thorough investigations. They took a look at how do we protect students with safeguarded channels going forward and NCAA punishment. They had accelerated what they're going to do when they're part of their cleanup. And yet people were furious. They wouldn't give them a new chance. Well, which one do you think got the most press out of all those? I'll show you which one it was. There was a Wharton study on that. And the one that got the most press was...
What an exciting day it was on the cable news channel. Nothing but this all day long. What could it be? All that fanfare. I know the president is in the Middle East trying to jumpstart the peace process, or they finally found those weapons of mass destruction we've heard so much about.
Martha Stewart has been indicted. 9-count indictment.
Martha Stewart has taken the walk into the federal courthouse, but it certainly is a tragedy.
10 years of jail time. Bear with me here because it's a pretty lengthy indictment. Martha Stewart knew what she was doing was wrong.
Act of terrorism, this is the number 2 priority for the Justice Department.
Martha Stewart. You know, with all the massive and almost completely unpunished fraud perpetrated on the public by companies like Enron, Global Crossing, Tiger, and Adelphia, we finally got the ringleader. Maybe now we can lower the nation's terror alert to periwinkle.
Well, you get the idea. I'm one of the few, perhaps the only one in this room, who doesn't think she did anything wrong. I think she tried to, but she didn't succeed at it. I believe in her case even more than she does, but she lost the support of 26-year-old ad buyers who panicked and withdrew their ads in the media. But her buyers, people still cared about the threads per square inch of her fabrics and whatever else, the quality of her goods, more than they cared about the threads of her story. Yes, at Dissent.
Hi, I'm David Weber.
Oh, David, hi.
Haven't met yet.
Yes.
I'm the former chief investigator of the Securities and Exchange Commission.
And you would say about Martha Stewart.
Are you saying that she did not make a false statement to my investigators?
Well,
because that's what she was convicted.
I knew we were going to offend some people here. I thought it'd be your friends first. Martha Stewart, what you guys let go, number one.
You didn't answer my question.
Number one, she, as we're hearing right now, this could be a long digression on this, she wasn't under oath. And I thought you could say still, it's federal prosecutors. Still, she wasn't under oath, so many lawyers would argue as to whether or not a perjury charge would hold up. Secondly, she did try to tamper with evidence, you're right. Potentially, pathetically untampered with it, so everything forked over to you was what it was. Third,
she should perjure herself. I asked her if she made a false statement to an official acting
Then she corrected. The issue was whether or not she sold $60,000 worth of stock. Daniel Fanuel, who was the person that you guys shook down, was an assistant to her broker. And he was, they were dangling drug charges against him that were suspiciously dropped as he gave an ambivalent testimony against her, but certainly a witness that could be impeached and was inconsistent with what his boss had to say. So if that was your evidence that she lied, no, he was a questionable witness. The other really strong witness of the three you had was a woman named Marianne Pasternak. She was the wife of a physician and the former best friend of Martha's who testified that Martha told her, isn't it great to have friends who tell you things like this tip she supposedly got? Well, interestingly, her husband sold on the very same day, the very same hour, four times as much stock as Martha did, and you guys didn't prosecute him or even raise charges against him. There's a deal done to get this testimony from this Marianne Pasternak, which she recanted on the trial, and the judge wouldn't let her recant, because what she said in trial was, actually, maybe Martha didn't say that to me, I said that to Martha on the plane. They wouldn't let her reverse it. And the third other piece of evidence was all you had was a guy that you guys brought forward as an FBI handwriting analyst. Turns out he'd never been employed by the FBI. It wasn't even a handwriting analyst, and he perjured himself. He was never charged with perjury. He was under oath at testifying to who his credentials were. But I'm going to go on too much on the Martha Stewart thing, but I do think she got a bad rap, and she was never defended by criminal counsel. She had very fancy corporate defense counsel, and she did her time, but you may say she's still a bad guy compared to a bad person compared to all these heinous criminals we had up there. I think she was an easy target for prosecutorial zeal, and although she never went there and still hasn't to this day, I think there's a gender issue going on too. And even if she did everything wrong that you say that she did, Michael Milken did a lot worse. When Michael Milken came out, and I've done work with him, as he recharged his business and has everybody from clergy to Nobel laureates coming out to his Milken Institute, people celebrate him. From the minute he left prison, from the minute Martha left, people like Charlie Gasparino on Fox News, used to be at CNBC, and others were arguing with me, oh, she's clawing her way back, trying to restore, as if there's something wrong with her trying to restore her business. So, you know, if we could take it to the reception about Martha is my response to that. But I think the SEC is great. And I think that you don't refer for criminal prosecution. So whether or not she civilly did anything wrong, I don't know. But I don't think that she was a bad person. However, there were people you guys went after and did a great job with, if this is a point of conciliation. I think going after Ken Lay and Jeff Skilling and Bernie Ebers and looking at Tyco and Health South with Richard Scrushy and Dennis Kozlowski and our Bernie Ebers, although the SEC was a little late on Bernie Ebers, still, these were appropriate to go after, but they do ask us the question as to whether or not we should look for great titans of morality in the business world. We hear so much about these problems, and who is Elizabeth Holmes? Anybody know what's going on there?
She is the CEO of a company named Theranos, starting to do a blood test, had a lot of VC capital, and now there are some problems.
No problems. Would you say it's a fraud?
Would I say it's a fraud?
Yeah. Good, I would too. But you're a lawyer, so you can say it with expertise. And I think this is a company that had this pinprick technology that's supposed to do these 260 diagnostic tests. As it turns out, only one test were they really using it on. They were using, for the other 259 ailments, they were actually taking your pinprick blood and diluting it with other fluid and putting it in the same vial that Quest would use, or their other competitors, using the same Siemens equipment as others. And it wasn't this pinprick super space age technology after all. In fact, and even the one test they were using it on, it had a 50-50% chance of being right. So the thing was collapsed, and at least the two of us agree on that one. This really was fraud. And I put this up there just as a reminder, there's no gender that has a monopoly on integrity here either. Is I will admit what Martha did was shady. Whether or not she's the one who should have gone to prison and some others didn't is a different story. But you know what? It's not just the corporate world. In the world of nonprofits, even in this area, William Aramone, who he lived not too far from here, was the CEO of United Way. His massive fraud was any pencil or desk or piece of paper that United Way used nationwide was sold through his sole-sourced private business. He and his son were running, and with twin teenage girlfriends, and so it came out to his unwinding, and it was quite a mess with a reputational stain that still hovers over United Way. Four CEOs later, they've really cleaned themselves up. But the New Era scandal, 160 higher educational and religious institutions caught up in a literal Ponzi scheme. People would say, you know, give me X to John Bennett and he'll give you 2X back to your charity. Well, it was just reshuffling money. It was very much of a Madoff scheme, even more malevolent, if you could imagine. And eventually it unraveled. We can find in the university world, we've had plenty of scandals we don't need to get into here. But we can find that, wow, then where do we look if it's not there? You know, and of course, we know the problems in the sports world. We might we'll think of Carnival Cruises first as with 3,000 people at sea. And Mickey Arison of Carnival Cruises was still off the Miami Heat game instead of telling anybody where the relatives were, what's the plan to get them back. When the Costa Concordia crashed and 30 people died off the coast of Florida, they tried to pretend, off the coast of Italy, that it was a separate division, a different company, that Costa Cruise Lines wasn't part of Carnival. It is these shell games, dodging accountability. It was really just shameful. Well, gosh, where do we look? As heroes, villains, cheerleaders, empty suits. Well, we have great entrepreneurs. Are they truly heroic? There's a very good book by Leo Browdy at USC that he called The Frenzy of Renown. And it's important to separate what's celebrity versus heroism. These people have changed the world. They changed the way we live. There are aspects of some of their characters we like more than others. That's Simona's IPO day. And yet, many people ape them and think, well, I'm going to be a hero then. Well, in the world of technology, I was on the cutting edge. I pushed the envelope. I did the heavy lifting. I was the rainmaker. Then I ran out of metaphors. There's a lot of cliches out there. And in fact, some have been skeptical. The Steve Kaplan, University of Chicago, has had a stream of research suggesting, he's an economist, saying that, well, and this is how it's summarized in the Times, the question, in praise of dullness, should CEOs read novels? The question seems to answer itself. After all, CEOs work with people all day. Novel reading should give them greater psychological insight, a feel for human relationships, a greater sensitivity toward their own emotional cords. Sadly, though, most of the recent research suggests that these are not the most important talents for a person who is trying to run a company. In other words, warm, flexible, team-oriented, and empathetic people are less likely to thrive as CEOs. Organized, dogged, and anal retentive, slightly boring people are more likely to thrive. And he goes on, basically, as any of the game theorists in the room would know, he's looking at people that will succeed in a hit-and-run game scenario where you don't return back to the same partners at the same table. And why would that be? Because in his massive database, which gave him a big N for the scholars in the room, the media wasn't asking, but still, despite the big N, who are those people? They were uniformly, 100% of them, were the turnaround managers brought in by the venture capital backers of founding entrepreneurs who had been replaced. These are people who were all brought in with not a built-to-be-great mission, it was built to flip. They had a short-term agenda, so they were performing as short-term leaders. And, well, do CEOs matter? Is this questions has come up. In fact, we have these issues out there, whether or not it's corruption that we talked about, cronyism or cowardice, conformity, indispensable. People can think they're indispensable. They might think there is on earth one person truly indispensable, that themselves, the grandiosity, a messiah-like rock star thoughts, simple recipes that people can follow in airport magazine books or whatever, empowerment, leaderless groups, which are very important. Hank, I think the leaderless group is really important, but the role of significant individuals, we tend to sometimes put so much attention. Bosses as empty-suited cheerleaders, sometimes we vilify them, sometimes we celebrate them. The great person theory of history has been challenged by none other than Tolstoy. If you may remember back in high school, if you read War and Peace, or if you're still reading it because it's only about 1,100 pages, is about halfway through, Tolstoy talks about Napoleon, featured here, as like a child, like a little boy or a little girl on a coach holding ribbons in her hands, pretending those ribbons are connected to the steeds, that those are the ropes driving the reins of power forward. And what's amazing is that he said that overstates the true complexity, the geopolitical complexity of what was happening in 1812 between France and Russia, or between Britain and the U.S. There's so much more going on that to blame it all on a villainous Tolstoy simplified things too much. And that's his argument, even though this cover he would have hated were he alive. He would have preferred a selection of one of the many other covers that actually feature what Tolstoy thought was really going on there is not Napoleon, but everything else in the political and economic dynamics of that time. Well, it's a great person theory of history. It's all symbolism, he argued. Well, my argument is that symbolism matters, and Tolstoy is wrong. that individual leaders do matter. Now, admittedly, I am a native Philadelphian, so I won't take you down this path, but we do often look in the world of sports for models. Then if the business world is complicated for us, can we find a sense of right and wrong and winners and losers so we can celebrate in the sports world sometimes? Or as political leaders, yes, I mean, many of these people have had some character traits we question, but their legacies are incredible. The world's different because they've lived. In fact, some of them have such a broad reach. So you see Charles de Gaulle there, or Sun Yat-sen. Sun Yat-sen was a mentor to Chiang Kai-shek as well as to Chairman Mao. And same with de Gaulle. You have Gaullists on the left and Gaullists on the right. You could have Perón. You could have Juan Perón of Argentina. The left and the right both claim him as a mentor. That these people have often transcended ideologies of even Mandela, and where would we be in modern Europe without Angela Merkel and things? Then we have back on our own doorstep. We may wonder if we have contemporary leaders as leaders of state, are the models to turn to, or sports the models, the business world? Yes, we spend time here, which we can talk about later during a break, as to what has worked and not worked. But then we have this example, which is now back in the news. Anybody know who these people are? They are a reminder that maybe, Bill, you were in the Air Force? Is that maybe we have models in the military can help us out for perhaps what it is that we are looking for in a time of distress. There's a great new film coming out that actually has these people playing themselves.
3:15 in the afternoon for what should be a 3-hour trip to Paris. On board are three American friends enjoying a European vacation together. 2 hours later, the train makes a stop in Brussels, where alleged gunman 25-year-old Ayub Kazani, a Moroccan native, gets on board. Minutes later, a shirtless Kazani emerges from a bathroom located between cars 11 and 12 in first class. He makes his way back to car 12, where he's confronted by Mark Mugalian, also an American from North Carolina, who teaches English in France. Mugalian manages to wrestle the assault rifle from the gunman, but Kazani shoots Mugalian in the neck with a pistol and grabs the rifle back. It's that gunshot that alerts the three American friends. It's 5:50 p.m.
The gunshot was probably the first noise I heard, and then that was followed by some breaking glass. So the gunshot was pretty much the first thing that came to our attention. I didn't know it was a gunshot at the time, but that was like the first thing I heard. It was behind me, so I had no idea where he was aiming it or what he intended to do.
22-year-old Oregon National Guardsman Alex Scarlatos, fresh from a tour of duty in Afghanistan, is the first to react, shouting, "Get him!" His buddy, 23-year-old Spencer Stone, a martial arts enthusiast and in the Air Force, leads the charge toward the suspect.
Ran down, tackled him, we hit the ground. Alec came up and grabbed the gun out of his hand while I put him in a chokehold. It seemed like he just kept pulling more weapons left and right, pulled out a handgun. Al took that, took out a box cutter, started jabbing at me with that. We let go. All three of us started punching him while he's in the middle of us. And then I was able to grab him again and choke him unconscious while Alec was hitting him in the head with the pistol or rifle. I can't really remember.
Stone is severely slashed by a box cutter, nearly losing his thumb and suffering injuries to his neck and head.
The guy had a lot of ammo. I mean, his intentions were pretty clear.
Yeah.
That's when the third American, Anthony Sadler, helps tie the suspect up, aided by British man Chris Norman. Despite his injuries, Stone begins rendering first aid to Magalian, who is bleeding badly from his neck. Meanwhile, Sadler uses his phone to capture the first chaotic moments after the violent struggle. Then Sadler goes car to car, spreading the news to terrified passengers, the danger is over. 10 minutes after the first shot, the train is diverted off the main line and rerouted to the town of Arras, about 115 miles north of Paris. The gunman is taken into police custody. These pictures show what appear to be additional magazines suggesting that the attacker planned to reload numerous times. The injured and wounded are taken to area hospitals. All indications are the quick, thick, thinking Americans, aided by others, prevent what could have been a massacre on a train moving at close to 200 miles per hour.
Why did this work out seemingly so well? What's your theory? Is there anything that they could possibly have in common with Sharon Watkins or Ken Frazier? All right, yes, USA, US. Well, they had British and French assistance, as you saw too. They weren't solitary heroes, but there are others there. The groups helped. But yeah, there was something about American can-do spirit that we like to think mattered there, but there were others involved. What else would you have in addition? Because all the bad guys we put up on those slides before were Americans too.
They were successful.
They were successful. Why were they successful?
Well, they had an end result that most of us would say is good, and that is that they stopped the terrorist attack. And when an individual is successful, one is that individual is more likely to have good things attributed to that person.
Excellent. Success.
If they had failed, then the question is, would they then be heroes? I don't know if they would.
Well, that's a really good point. There was a guy who ran into a burning building who was on leave in Harlem a month ago. He died. We'd still consider him successful, right? He's a hero. He was a hero, and he saved some people, but not himself and not everybody. So, but the success does breed success, and it triggers something in others. I think it's a very good point. But we do have graveyards filled with heroes, you know, just because they didn't succeed. You remember we did have one prominent politician a year and a half ago said, I admire the guys who didn't get caught, not the prisoners of war. So that was a little controversial, but somehow didn't get in his way. Yes?
Well, they acted quickly and they supported each other. So they worked together.
Acted quickly and supported each other, too. This is one of your fields, right? Collective action. Is that they did work together as a team really well, even though some of them were strangers. Total strangers jumped in board. What did I flash up here in the New York Times? I'll summarize this for you. This was a piece that Joe Nocera, who's now at Bloomberg, was at the New York Times, wrote a searing piece that came out a couple of years ago, 7 years ago, in December. There was a terrible scene where a Korean-American was pushed onto a train platform. I don't know if you saw it or any of the coverage of it, but because there was some pretty terrible footage that accompanied it. But a Korean-American was pushed onto a train platform by a deranged person, and nobody seemed to respond. This is what it looked like. This is one of the less, if you can imagine, upsetting photos that was on the front page of the New York Post. Why? Because this man got pushed down there. You can see he's very slight. Any three of us, maybe any two of us, maybe in some cases one of us, could have lifted this slight man to safety, only like chest high in a train platform. There's about 30 seconds, it's the closest between trains. Usually it's about a minute, or sometimes a few minutes. But in this case, they had ample time. 18 people watched. Nobody lifted a finger except the one guy who lifted a finger to snap these photos for Rupert Murdoch to put in his sleazy New York Post with captions about showing this man's head crushed like a pumpkin, as they said. Imagine his family. Imagine anybody just watching this. And what Nocera said in that New York Times piece I flashed up at you is, how dare we go to seminars like this and talk about heroic leadership? We're not heroic. It's self-congratulatory behavior. It's CEOs, cheerleaders, sports figures, politicians, pretending we are. But he said, maybe we're New Yorkers or Northeasterners or Americans, or maybe it's humanity, but our tendency is toward cowardice, is what he said with that scene. And he drew on the Kitty Genovese killing. Who in this room of the social psych? Who is Kitty Genovese?
Kitty Genovese was screaming and yelling and begging for help in Queens, New York. And hundreds of people who were her neighbors heard her, and nobody even called 911 because they all assumed someone else would.
They all assumed somebody else would. 1964, it's actually only 38 people, but it felt like hundreds. 38 people watched in this courtyard. Nobody offered to help. But very good, thanks. And they didn't call 911 because it didn't exist yet, but nobody called the police. They could have. Nobody even opened a window and shouted for their assailant to run away or get away. Nobody did anything to help her. They kept knifing this young woman in Kew Gardens, not too far from LaGuardia, in a nice neighborhood in Queens. And then not a sketchy, dangerous, abandoned area. But her screams were enough to drive off her assailant. When still nobody came down to help her as she lay in a pool of her own blood, he came back and finished his horrible task and other things I won't even get into that were just awful that he did to her in full view of these people. And what Joe Nocera says in this piece, look at that. And we have in social psychology, a lot of you are familiar with the Latané and Darley studies as a Princeton and a Columbia social psychology and sociology team came out with a term called diffusion of responsibility that most of the rest of us would call bystander apathy, which could be CEOs, athletes, academics, and clergy. Any of us can fall victim to it, is that thinking somebody else is doing something about it. This was Sharon Watkins' frustration. There were other people in there, at Vinson and Elkins, the law firm, or at McKinsey, or at Merrill Lynch, or all the other firms saying, well, somebody else is overseeing this. I mean, this doesn't look right to me, but if they think it's okay. The one guy on the board who was raising issues, the Washington Post came out with board transcripts that they printed in this era where they still used to have board transcripts that told you something as opposed to the dehydrated, sanitized record now. There was a guy named Mickey LeMater, who was the head of the MD Anderson Cancer Center, retired, who said, wait a minute, how can this CFO be on both sides of the equation? Or how can we pay him this? And what do you call these loans non-recursive when they are recursive? And they said, oh, you're just an academic. You don't know business. So all these business people belittled him. But he asked the question. It still wasn't enough. And so you wonder, and Joe Nocera says, this is who we are, we're cowards. Is that right? How about those guys on the French train? How about Sharon Watkins? How about Ken Frazier? And how about this scene? Just a few months after Joe Nocera published that piece, this was in Logan City, Utah. This was a speeding Mercedes smashed into
is thanking a group of strangers for saving his life today. 21-year-old Brandon Wright was riding near Utah State University in Logan when he collided with a BMW. What happened next is nothing short of amazing. As reporter Chris Jones shows us, almost a dozen people risked their own lives to save Wright, and it was all caught on camera.
We were getting ready to shoot a lecture.
Chris Gard shoots video for Utah State.
You can see on the ninth floor, the very top floor, on that second window.
And from this pane of glass,
notice some black smoke.
He starts shooting,
obviously shocked,
the most compelling images of his life.
The motorcycle was shooting flames out of the gas tank.
This motorcycle slides underneath this car and is dragged, sparking a raging fire.
Oh my gosh.
My gosh.
Chris can see the flames, but what he doesn't know is there is someone trapped.
People were getting down and looking underneath the car, and you could see panic. And when I saw that panic, I'm like, there's someone either in the car or underneath the car.
Get them out of the car. Get them out of the car.
A woman appears to be speaking to the unconscious man. Half a dozen people try to...
Look at this guy. First started blew it by himself.
We're carrying them on, like, get that car up. We got to get that guy out of there.
But no luck. Then a flood of people swarm the car and crane it into the air.
Oh, my gosh.
A construction worker drags the limp body from underneath 4,000...
What do you make of that? Doesn't that make you proud to be an American? That is who we are, and somehow we have to recapture that and remember it. How did that happen? Was it because it was Logan City, Utah, instead of New York City? Why did it work there and not New York? Anybody have an implicit theory?
I think one of them was a leader.
Oh, jumped right to the quick. Because you might say, well, urban, and this is what Latané and Darley's fans were saying, well, maybe it's because of the cruelty of the urban setting. People wouldn't care in a big city. But here's a big city that you're more familiar with. Anybody here ever ride in the metro? This is a guy, there's no sound with it. The wheelchair misfired. And nobody pushed nobody on, but now he has no legs, so he can't even help himself. And you have the contraption, you have the equipment there further. So this computer scientist jumps down, leaves his daughter in the hands of strangers to watch, and other people come by, and they all come racing down and join him. And it's a scene where they're putting themselves all in great jeopardy, at great risk. Exactly what Joe Nocera says we can't do and don't do. Here are scenes where, in fact, it's happening. In fact, this is a little bit crisper view of it from another angle, with another camera down there. If you're up to anything bad, by the way, on the Metro, you shouldn't do it. We got you on camera. But you can see how people realize there's something wrong, and there's a response. And the SEC jumps to the quick to tell us, you're right. It says, because somebody took initiative as a leader that made a difference. In fact, over the summer, Louisiana.
Give me a knife.
We're coming.
Watch your eyes.
Chinese American helping a Louisiana Cajun woman.
Watch your eyes!
Break
in
the window.
Stop on the ground.
We're coming.
We're breaking the window.
You do that. Tell me if you have enough to find out.
These are really swift-moving currents, and you can't tell that from the scene, but it's great risk. And then she wouldn't leave without her dogs, so he went back in to get the dogs. She said, well, it's still not New York City. Oh, yeah? The same subway. A guy jumps down there this fall. Somebody else had a drug interaction and got dizzy. So there you have it. Like, how can you explain some situations where it works and some where it doesn't? Well, as let me give you, another example is we talked about Theranos and the fraud there.
Era of invention. Is Tyler here? In this era of invention, you sometimes find some people that are doing some pretty disreputable things that are out of a doubt. It's sheer hearsay works and happened at all. Where did you get the courage to go forward? And you contacted the Wall Street Journal?
This is the whistleblower who broke Theranos open. You've never seen him before. He's facing so much litigation. Wall Street Journal got a Pulitzer Prize for the story. It's this guy's story. No prizes went to him. His grandfather, is George Shultz, former Secretary of State in his mid-90s. Fearless, his grandfather on the board is being defrauded by this company, and he's a biochemist in there, so he went to his granddad to alert him. His granddad said, oh, this is horrible, Tyler. Let's call Elizabeth and tell her. He said, no, she's the bad person here. She's the villain. Oh, we'll call her. So they call her, and they unleash a nasty, the Boise law firm comes crushing down on him, and Shultz doesn't know what to do. To this day, they've not reconciled the grandson and the grandfather, nor between us, with the son, his dad, and his grandfather. They're off on their own. The son is a biology professor, his dad, and the mother is a nurse, and this put them in tremendous distress.
No, I did not. Actually, John Kerry contacted me through LinkedIn. I think being naive kind of helped a little bit. You know, if I could have seen what I was going to go through when I first called John Kerry, I don't know if I would have done it. But, you know, taking these things one piece at a time, you're able to get through it. Whereas, you know, if going back, if I told myself when I was buying that burner phone to call John Kerry, if I said, this phone call is going to cost you more than $400,000, would I have still done it? I hope that I would, because I do believe that patients were saved.
She threatened you quite a bit. You had to deal with a lot of lawyers, a lot of litigation.
Oh, yeah, definitely. David Boyce is definitely a tenacious lawyer and does not like losing, so.
And your parents thought they're going to have to sell their house to keep to pay for the litigation.
We knew that if we had entered litigation with a firm like Boyce Schiller, that it would cost $2 million regardless of whether we won or lost. And, you know, my dad's a high school biology teacher, my mom is a nurse, we don't have $2 million just laying around. Luckily, they did buy a house in Los Gatos almost 30 years ago, so that house is worth a little more than $2 million now, so that's where the money is going to come from.
They had to mortgage their house to do the right thing. The parents weren't even sure at first their son was doing the right thing, and his grandfather thought it was the wrong thing. Is that, what's the lesson from this? How do we figure out who's going to act, who's going to act in the public interest? How do we reinforce people to do the right thing? And when do we know the CEOs are going to do it for us? Because they're like everybody else in this situation. This is another example that last spring, a ballet dancer is a similar set of tracks. I didn't show you all the footage. In fact, this could happen to any one of us. This was this October outside of my house, this car. As I, you know, was trying to think about putting my thoughts together on this topic. My mind is wandering. I see this woman smash just like, and in fact, I went over to help this guy, this older guy ahead of me, pulled her out. I was just assisting him, pulling her across the street as her car burst into flames, is how she is today. Is that, why do we not act? Well, there's groupthink, which is, of course, an Irving Janis term for a conforming behavior of sorts, where people are afraid to stand out in front, to challenge the norms. That Ken Frazier had to deal with all these CEOs, said, oh, I don't know, it's not worth it. He's going to humiliate us, and the costs are too high. Nobody wants to be the skunk in the lawn party. Nobody wants to stand apart from the crowd. Groupthink, it's a sense of righteousness around the group's initiative. So those whistleblowers at Enron, or the space shuttle disasters, or wherever we looked at all the relevant knowledge, Pearl Harbor, that people knew what we needed to know, but they weren't listened to. They were disparaged. The dissent was equated with disloyalty, and they didn't consider, what if we're wrong? What are alternatives? So groupthink was one barrier. Another is obedience to authority, that you know from the famed Milgram studies, those shocking studies where people thought that they were shocking another subject to death because an experimenter told them to do so. And the diffusion of responsibility, we talked about that with the murder in New York City of Kitty Genovese, thinking, well, somebody else will take care of it, bystander apathy. This cowardice, conformity, this is a huge cluster of issues that have to be challenged. Why do some beat it and some others? My bottom line is, and you may have a better set of theories, because I'm just trying to figure this out myself. I'm interested, for those of you who are interested in those Milgram studies, these studies were initially done at Yale. 80% of people would go ahead and shock somebody thinking they're killing them, even though they said they didn't want to. When we'd take off the lab jackets and Milgram would go off to a shopping center, I say we, but I never knew him, but it was still more than half the people would do it, even though they were wearing a loud blazer and they weren't trying to invoke a name of a university to get it done, is that they're still going along with it. Why is that? But somebody said no. I'm interested, not where all my colleagues are interested in the group dominant effect, I'm interested in those who depart from the norm. There's something in the clarity of the situation. Can you tell when it's a crisis? When you respond, how do you respond? How do you know? Last week we had 70 university presidents and college and university presidents together talking about campus crises, and some responded very well, as you've read about, and some did very badly. As you can imagine, Michigan State University was not with us, but we talked about them. We try to figure out, sometimes you're just not sure in the heat of battle. So it's sometimes in the context, the clarity of what's going on, the effect of the crowd, the familiarity of people there in the situation, urgency. Bill, your expertise is risk. You know, what's the great risk here? But look at the character and how that matters. Were they competent? Do we know what makes a difference? Do we know, can we be a rebellious character and still get others to follow us? Can we be independent-minded? The courage, the values that come in there. Of course he was cut down in his prime. Don't you get it? We're all cut down in our prime. You know, bad things happen, but are we ready for them? Can we define a crisis? How does that happen? You can prepare for it in case studies and simulations or just anticipating. How will you respond in those situations? Who would you be like in those train situations? Which subway, if you were in the crowd, and then you saw one of these subway incidents, or it doesn't have to be around a train, on the flooding or any of those situations, the exploding car, how would you respond? How can you anticipate trying to identify, is this really a crisis or not? And then, what is it in the character of a hero? I don't need to be too psychoanalytical, but the people we celebrated had setbacks in their lives. And Hank, we were just talking about that as we opened up today. Hank and I have had little logs thrown in our path. Some of us had giant timbers thrown in our paths, and with howitzers attached, if that didn't work. And yet, when you get through it, as Nietzsche says, what doesn't kill me makes me stronger, is the resilience that comes back from earlier setbacks. When you take a look at, this is stolen from Joseph Campbell, I should have credited it here, is that these are the life stages of heroes, as he calls it, the monomyth of a hero. In an age of cultural relativism, we don't have cultural universalism anymore, that's a big no-no, yet he still was a cultural universalist who said we do have a hero myth common across cultures and continents and centuries, that we have a call to greatness, a common origin call to greatness, go out, slay some dragons, and we're on a rising success trajectory, but just a kind of run-of-the-mill rising manager until there's some crushing setback. And it's that failure, that setback that punctuates our lives. Those few of us that make it through are forever changed for that experience, and it's that rebound that's so helpful. As you can imagine, growing up in a drug-infested North Philadelphia, as Ken Frazier did, to break away from that, to redefine himself, there were issues in Sharon Watkins' life, and spirituality had a big part of that, is that every one of these heroes we looked at, there's something about their character in their earlier years that helped explain why and who they are today. There's business folk heroes, they all present themselves, true or not, of humble origins. You know, Henry Ford was, you know, his father was a pretty prosperous farmer, and his sisters wrote their own autobiographies that were very different telling of history than Henry Ford's, but we all present ourselves as humble origins, suffering, crushing, some setbacks and sweeping visions, self-promoters, even Edison, you name it. The current commander-in-chief is not the only prominent leader who's ever been a self-promoter. People, FDR, that, you know, when the third and fourth terms were all his manipulation, made it seem like it was a groundswell of support. We've had this with us before. A role model, what does a hero provide? Why does society need heroes? Something to identify with, and a code of conduct. And yes, sloganeering, sometimes we hate it. We hate the little Marco and lying Ted or crooked Hillary or all that other nonsense. However, those who do it well can take complex situations and reduce it to something understandable. And by the way, I am not celebrating insults. We're just saying that people who are very good at framing complex situations, they're probably bad, picked a bad example picking the president right there, but those who can digest complexity for us, that's a heroic quality. Sense of justice, what's fair, what's appropriate, path through volatility, resilience from adversity. These are why we need heroes that were common in all those situations. And as you were right, it's that somebody moved forward, is that others responded in this situation when somebody took the initiative to act. Is what was different is nobody acted with that first, Rupert Murdoch photograph. Is the crowd was paralyzed in action. Are crowds evil? Are they cowardly? They can be. They can be courageous. They can be good. They can be bad. That's the role of leadership. I wrote a book on all this, which I won't torture you with anymore. But basically, if I could show you just a couple seconds of such a hero, a business hero, to close with. This is a guy, Jimmy Dunn, who was the CEO of Sandler O'Neill, and still is. It was a mid-sized investment bank, which is now quite large, that was in the shadows. At 9/11, he lost a third of his workforce.
The Twin Towers of the World Trade Center were more than just symbols of American finance. The people who worked there were the very heart of it. Like the small investment banking firm of Sandler O'Neill, its headquarters were on the 104th floor of the South Tower. But its roots were all over America, providing financial expertise and services to small and medium-sized banks and savings and loans in places like Wayne, New Jersey, Sioux City, Iowa, and Santa Barbara, California. Of Sandler O'Neill's 171 employees, 83 reported for work at the World Trade Center on the morning of September 11th. Only 17 made it out alive. No one believed that the firm could recover, except perhaps for the people who worked there and let us follow and document their year-long fight for survival. We first began reporting on what was left of Sandler O'Neill just a few days after the attack. The firm had regrouped in a small midtown office, joined by crisis counselors and therapists. The surviving members were searching hospitals for lost colleagues and trying to console and help the families and friends of the dead or missing.
Hey, Bill Hickey. How you doing, buddy? Hey, I just wanted to say hello and see if I could do anything for you, bud.
The bankers and brokers and analysts had all worked the phones before, but never like this. Physically drained, emotionally numb, medicated with their own adrenaline.
I've already touched base today with Wright, Clark, Edwards, Collins, Wisnowski, and Brett.
Okay. The names of the families went on and on. Analysts, researchers, rainmakers, number crunchers, secretaries, and partners.
I was with Patty Rosalind's for him.
Okay.
Yeah. How's she doing?
She helped me more than I helped her.
Sorry about all this bouncing around.
Sandler O'Neill's biggest asset had always been its people. They made their living with their brains and their personal relationships. Now that intellectual and human capital had been depleted.
It was just incredible that 66 people could be missing. And nothing. Just like they were gone.
As that grim reality set in, the job of leading the crippled firm fell on the shoulders of its 45-year-old managing partner, Jimmy Dunn.
Well, you see, not everyone's been found.
There had been discussions about selling or liquidating the firm, but Dunn made it his mission to try and keep it alive. For the surviving employees, for more than 100 parents who lost sons and daughters, for the 46 widows and widowers, and their 71 children under the age of 18.
How's this guy doing? Well, I'm sad but focused.
The work helped deaden the pain, made them feel relevant. Within 4 days of the attack, they had already moved into temporary quarters, a customer service area given to them by Bank of America. But the firm's phone system, computer network, corporate records, and virtually every piece of paper had all been destroyed, along with the people who knew the most about them.
We have no record of the deals and done this year. Who the hell knows what's going to be?
A list of their clients and phone numbers had to be reconstructed from memory. Entire departments had been wiped out. Almost all of the bond and stock traders killed, along with two of the firm's top executives, Herman Sandler and Chris Quackenbush. But Jimmy Dunn wasn't about to give up.
This is an attack on the United States of America. This is an attack on our capitalistic system, which we've thrived and benefited from forever. You know, and I personally have. You know, they attacked my firm. They killed 66 of my people. They killed my best friends.
If this was war, Sandler O'Neill had plenty of allies. Brokerage houses and investment banks, competitors in what had been the cutthroat world of Wall Street finance, offered equipment, people, and services. Whatever Sandler O'Neill needed to stay alive.
So, we're here and we're doing business.
6 days after the attack, the day the stock market was set to reopen, Sandler O'Neill had assembled a makeshift trading floor staffed by employees from other offices and departments, by friends, relatives, and volunteers, like Bobby Castrignano, a retired vice president at Goldman Sachs, who walked in off the street.
That day was extraordinary. I'll never forget it, walking in the room, introducing myself to people I'd not known, and them asking me, who are you and how can you help? And I said, well, I can take an order, or I can relay an execution price to a customer, or if things get really bad, I can get your lunch.
Before the bell sounded, Terry Maltese, who had been running Sandler's investment fund, moved in and took charge for Frank Salvaterra, Bruce Simmons, and 20 others who had died on the trading floor.
This has been a horrible week, as everybody knows. And it's amazing what's happened, and it's amazing everything we've had to do, and I'm very proud of everything we have done here. I'm more sad about everything we've lost than that we had to do this. Talking to the families was the worst thing. We've got a lot of...
They actually kept paying the bonuses that were due the victims' families while their much larger competitors at that time cut off the victims' families, saying, well, they're not around to claim it anymore, and we're going to perish as a firm anyway. So Morgan Stanley, Cantor Fitzgerald, and Keith Broyette Woods and others, off the record, initially said, we're not paying them. These guys said, we may be the Davids among these Goliaths, and we may go out of business. And we may only be in the venal world of Wall Street, but we can have principles and purpose. And if we go out, we're going to go out with purpose. So they started to pay the bonuses due the victims' families. And to this day, they cover health care and education for those families and contributed quite charitably, quite generously to the families of the public safety workers rushing into the buildings that their people were rushing out of. It's an impressive model. If you go to their website today, they still have a tribute to those people.
The market is going to open today, and we're going to make those trades. Yes, our friends are gone, the desk is gone. We're here, and make no mistake, Bruce and Frankie are here, and they're watching us, and we're not going to disappoint them.
Now we're open.
Thank you.
but nothing went according to plan.
What is with these phones?
Mark, you're gonna have to use that. Is that phone good?
Yeah, we gotta take that phone. They're now the largest truly independent investment bank because others, they stay private.
Hours.
Four times the size they were.
The company's biggest problem. One of the cable news channels erroneously reported that Sandra O'Neill had suspended operations and was going out of business. So Jimmy Dunn, who had never done an interview before, went live on CNBC to let his clients and the financial community know that Sandra O'Neill was still around.
You know, we don't, you know, write songs. We don't write novels. We're Wall Street people. We're going to respond as we know how.
And respond they did. A group of programmers and software specialists who had worked for an old college roommate of Jimmy Dunn's drove all night from Chicago to work on the computers. But no one from the outside world could help the employees of Sandra O'Neill with their grief.
The funeral was...
I know.
It was brutal. I talked to his grandmother, and she was reliving old stories and started crying. You know, what are you going to do?
We're going to get through it. That's what we're going to do.
Across the front of the office on spreadsheets normally used to report sales and earnings was a long list of funerals, wakes, and memorial services. And Jimmy Dunn was determined that there would be a Sandra O'Neill partner at every one.
Oh, God. My best friend's on Saturday. That guy that we were in the same summer house with 20 years ago for 6 years is the same day, same time. And then a great friend of mine's that morning, so I'll be both of those. And Hearns is on Monday, so yeah. I will miss him every day for the rest of my life.
The services were heartrending, exhausting, and relentless in their sheer numbers, sometimes two and three a day into the month of November.
I want to go to the wake, so...
Every day seemed a whipsaw between somber responsibilities and small celebrations that marked Sandra O'Neill's return to Wall Street.
So, congratulations, boys, on the job you did on the Allies.
First deal we announced after 9/11.
Were it not for this one individual, the firm would have collapsed. There's no dispute about that. A single individual made a difference, and there are people in this room. Hank, you're one of the great leaders in understanding group leadership and self-directed work teams, and the empowerment movement was so important. But we need to not forget at the same time, the rest of us have to keep in mind at least, the role of individual leaders too, and you've never said that they don't matter. But we have to balance it. Sometimes the pendulum in our field has swung too far, where if you go to any parts of Washington, along the Potomac, or in your towns at home, your squares, villages, hamlets from all over the world, in the town square, it's a statue, probably not to a task force, not to an executive committee, to bold-thinking individuals that make a difference. So we need to keep that in mind, too. There are certain things that people have done well to come back in, but it was the idea of what Jimmy Dunn did, or what those American soldiers did on that Parisian flight, or what people did in the floods, as you saw that guy jumping in the waters in Louisiana, or what we saw with the burning car in Utah, what we saw on the train platforms here in Washington or in New York, is that we can make a difference. We don't have to be cowards. Thomas More had an admonition. Of course, it's just before he had his head chopped off, so maybe you want to keep this in question. As an advisor to King Henry VIII, he reminded us how character is as fragile as having a liquid cupped in your hands. And you can see, I don't know if you noticed, I have a drinking problem here. I've got liquid all over the desk here, sorry. Is that it's very fragile, and that the people we've celebrated here managed to keep those fingers webbed together. It's something we need to learn how to teach more and practice more to be the Ken Frasers of the business world and not some of the ones who showed cowardice or corruption. And then, of course, as I said, that line that I was going to close with, I gave you the plot spoiler right up front. As Ibsen said, the strongest person in the world is a person who can stand alone. If I go 1 minute longer, I'm going to be completely alone in this room. I really want to thank all of you coming out, and for 99% of you for staying. I'm very honored. Thank you.
Answers.
Or complaints.
Or complaints.
Did I redeem myself with the SEC is my big question. Yes, Bill?
We have a technology toy here.
Oh, right. Thanks. Yeah. Bill wants to say he's canceling the series. I've so ruined the.
Is this working?
Yeah, amazingly.
You have to talk into the top of it.
Yeah, you're going to have to hold it up.
Jeff, I'm a former litigator and CEO chairman of financial organizations, so I might have a slightly different view of Martha Stewart's bad behavior.
You have to, right? Any town that's too small for one law is just the right size for two. Is it? Yeah.
So, but there's certain givens, a certain commonality among all the names you had, all the people you had. One, they benefited financially mightily by their behavior.
Right.
Second, every one of them was smart enough to know, you mentioned Michael Milligan, of what people suffered from who behaved badly like them in the past. And I'll bet you that many of them had pretty good parents who told them to behave well. They didn't change them. They behaved, one might have behaved worse than the other, but they all behaved badly.
Yes.
As an academic institution, Professor Jeff, what do you think an academic institution, professor, can do? Many people, I bet you there's a lot of people in this room who are future CEOs, entrepreneurs. What can you do, in an educational sense to produce slightly different outcomes than what we saw with organizations?
Any suggestions there? I was trained in a case study method, so we throw the question right back. But yes, I have responses, but yes.
A class on ethics in every MBA program that this university holds.
Judy, you couldn't have said it better yourself, right?
I don't think I could have, but if I couldn't have, I know my buddy Rob here could have. He's the academic director of the executive MBA.
Rob, what do you think? Teaching ethics could make a difference?
Yes, but it's a challenge of how to do it and how to make a difference. I thought it was a fantastic question. It's a question that we think about a lot and try to work at figuring out how to make that kind of difference. Because I think with your presentation, which thank you very much.
Thanks.
Leadership can matter. And then whatever we can do to show people that and to encourage and inspire them to provide leadership at times when it's challenging, I think.
A single individual can have such a huge difference, as we saw with Jimmy Dunn or any one of those heroic portraits, that it wasn't just the vanity of celebrating, you know, some puffed up self-promoting CEO. These were people who really made a difference. So, and thinking then, who would we be in this situation to anticipate whether or not it's through literature, case studies, discussions of the news, is to consider what the situations are that are out there and what are alternative ways of behaving. You know, sometimes we just do certain things because it's a lack of resourcefulness or having the role models available to us. As people, when Ken Frazier did what he did, he made it a lot easier for Doug McMillon of Walmart to go to the Walton family, as he didn't say, back me up on this, and I wasn't going to name names, but there I did. Denise Morrison, I shouldn't, of Campbell's Soup, you know, to go to the family backing up Campbell's Soup, the Dorrance family, saying, listen, we should take, and then it's enough people, that the role models, others then followed what Ken Frazier did. So having, and teaching that you can make a difference and learn from the examples that we have a wider repertoire than people think. Other comments or questions, either following up on Bill's provocative one or additional one, I'll leave it to Amy to throw the weaponry. Whoa, Matt, did you just do that? Did you play ball when you were here? Wow. Uh-oh, you got to start a fight? Yes.
So with regard to teaching ethics, the question then is how to teach ethics, what sort of things. What I appreciated from your talk, actually, was bringing up leadership. And I think it's a lot easier to excite people about being leaders than being ethical. So with regard to how to be a leader, what do you think makes people like Watkins different from people who, would have acted differently in the same circumstances? And maybe different than the people on the train. I'll let you on that first.
You know, the way I originally got into this, I just didn't want to date myself that much, but then I was at that National Council on Aging meeting, so the cover's ruined anyway if appearances didn't give away. It was in 1976, 77, I interviewed people coming out of prison for price fixing. Some of them were CEOs, most of them were regional vice presidents and things, because I was concerned about the teaching of ethics that we were doing under the rubric of corporate social responsibility was the terminology we used instead of ESG or things or other terms we use today. And I thought a lot of the speeches, dinner speeches, that most of the meat was in the meal that preceded the speech, that the speech seemed pretty vacuous, a lot of truisms. And a lot of my colleagues at the evil Harvard were saying we can't teach Sunday school and there's something to that, or we can't teach philosophy, it's not going to translate to ethical conduct. I thought, well, let me just try to find people who did the wrong thing and then try to find people who did the right thing. These were price-fixing conspiracies where the same companies, this was folding cartons in this particular case, same companies were convicted of corrugated containers and multi-wall bags. And again, like, why were they making this? They're not learning. But there were some, then I thought it was kind of interesting. Some people did say no, though who were they? And, you know, it gets back to that list of the character traits that some had, the strength that they had, the confidence. The fact that those soldiers on the train acted the way they did, I think a lot of them had to do with their childhood upbringing. However, there are cowards in battle. What is it that made these? They were trained really well, too. And there was an esprit de corps between them as well. They knew they'd support each other. But they were prepared for crisis. So the preparation, it's and Louis Pasteur is one who reminded us that chance favors the mind that's prepared. We don't know what random act is going to happen to us. If we'd had more time, believe it or not, I know this thing ran long. I was going to torture you with so much more. I had different clips of Jim Burke of the Tylenol recovery than is commonly taught at business schools and interviews with him. Is they didn't actually get it right at Johnson & Johnson right away. They were referring to the Sunday school approach to ethics. They had this credo that was on the wall. But the truth is, and I had the footage to show you, but I'll ruin it by just telling you, is that the management committee interpreted that credo all different ways. Some people interpreted it by saying, yes, so we have to preserve and protect the Johnson & Johnson brand name and make that a McNeil Labs division issue and don't bring in Johnson & Johnson. Who did that? Well, when they had food poisoning at Taco Bell and KFC that got called KFR for a while, but anyhow, the CEO, Jan Brands, David Novak, said intentionally, we'll stonewall. He bragged about that. So sometimes people would do things that, you know, were just really, really terrible and not responding to it. And sometimes people did rise to the occasion with preparation, with anticipation. But anyhow, is looking at the same ethics. Some people approach it differently. And Jim Burke realized that what we have that is the most priceless thing is the Johnson & Johnson brand name that we inherited for over a century, that people were going to trust us. We went public with nothing more than saying, trust us. And it worked, and they came out, and I think it was a very impressive model. But sometimes getting past the simplistic Sunday school approach to really translate that into action matters. Yes?
So going back to this, I would just say going back to the Sunday school approach, I mean, I shy away from Sunday school because I teach executive MBAs, and I think they have a good sense of what's right and wrong. The question is, are they going to do it? And so we focus on cognitive biases, people, a lot of the ones you put up there, diffusion of responsibility, obedience to authority, things that make you think, the way you rationalize your own behavior. But something I'm looking at incorporating this year is giving voice to value, which kind of goes to the military guys that you were talking about. Mm-hmm. They had experience at running toward danger. And I think we need to give our students experience at stating what their intentions are and how they're going to behave based on their own values. And so that's something I'm looking at incorporating this year.
How's it worked so far when you tried it?
I haven't tried it yet. So the giving voice to values part is new. My class starts in April.
Well, we'll be very eager to hear what happens. Since I said I wasn't give this to you, but you've asked for it, let me just see if this plays. This is Jim Burke of Johnson & Johnson reflecting on the Tylenol recovery.
As well. An overwhelming number of you have told us you still trust Tylenol and the company that makes it. We are grateful for this support, and I am pleased to tell you what we have been doing to continue to earn it.
Oh, yeah.
First, we are reintroducing Tylenol capsules in safety seal packaging. These containers are sealed.
We took the medical director, who looked like Central Casting's idea of a medical director, just happened to. We put him on television, and all he did is say, trust us. What we were now doing, and I don't don't think we understood it as well as we do in retrospect, was that we were cashing in on 100 years, almost 100 years of trust that had been built up. Now, try to think about, which I've said to many people many times, who tell me what a wonderful job I did, and I did a very good job. I'm not suggesting I didn't. Try to think whether I could have saved the brand if it was the James E. Burke Company. All of the previous managements who built this corporation handed us a silver platter, the most powerful tool you could possibly have. And the thing that worries me most is that people don't understand that to the extent that they ought to. That institutional trust, which is real, palpable, and bankable. So that every act that every person puts into an organization that builds that trust is enhancing the value long term of the business. And everybody who does something that every improper payment or every time you put a product out that was inferior, you trade off that trust. And once we unleash the power of the corporation going through the whole Tylenol experience, it was all obvious that we were going to succeed. We are reintroducing our Tylenol capsules and...
Well, anyhow, I told you I wouldn't bother you with that, but your question was so good, I thought you'd want the vivid demonstration. Amy reminds me if I go on a minute longer, you will definitely have all abandoned me. I think my mic's even been cut. People are so tired of me. But I guess I'll also miss my train back and I'll lose my job and I'll have to be begging you for a job now. But thank you so much for coming and for staying and for your great comments. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thanks a lot. Great to see you again.
Yeah, see you in 30 years, right? Yeah.